Hey there, how's it going? Good to see you again. And if you're new here, hi, I'm Sir Wade. Today's video is going to be kind of a quick tip, something that I don't think a lot of people are doing, but it's very, very useful. Something that I do pretty much every time I open Maya at this point. And it has to do with lighting, because a lot of the time when you're an animator, you're told that you shouldn't really worry about lighting. And that's mostly true. You shouldn't worry about props and lighting and modeling and all the other parts of the pipeline. If you're trying to be an animator, usually you want to specialize. However, there is also an argument to be made about, you know, selling your shot and having it look good, and that's fine too, but we're not talking about lighting for rendering. We're not trying to make our shots look pretty for the demo reel at this point. This works for that, but this is more about you working actively in your animation. This is going to help you to be able to see what you're doing, to make better decisions about your characters, about your poses, things like that. So let me just show you what I mean. This is a rig. I downloaded this for free. This is the Link rig. There's a Zelda one. I'll review them and talk about them on the channel much more. This is what Link looks like when he comes in. Without the textures, he looks like this. You turn on the textures, looks like that. Looks great. However, he's very dark. It's very hard to see pretty much the other side of his face. Something that this video is gonna kind of tackle, one of the problems of Maya, is that as a surface wraps away from camera and the surface becomes more kind of parallel to the view focal angle, as things wrap around towards the edge, they turn black. If you look at Link's face here, his hair, his face, it just gets very dark. This happens all across his body. His arm does it, it gets very dark, very black, which is not always as much of an issue. Some rigs are worse than others. It just kind of depends on how they were set up. However, it's not helpful to you as an artist to see it this way when instead you could see it like that. So if I just go back and forth, you can now see that there's a pretty significant difference. If you were to be working with this character, you can see him a lot better. So you're gonna have an easier time making decisions and your audience is gonna have a much easier time seeing what's going on. And this is going to become even more important when you have environment, when you have props, or when you have a character with a darker complexion. Because of Maya's default behavior to fade edges to black, any details on darker tones are gonna get harder to see, especially if your character is starting to face away from camera. That's putting their face towards the edge, where it's going to start to darken features of the face that you want to be in focus. So if we jump over to the Dana and David rigs, who I will be reviewing very soon on the channel, I'm checking them out right now, you can see a before and after of without lights and with lights. So let's take a look at the Dana rig right here. Her hair is a very dark tone and her skin is a different color. However, when you look at the left, they kind of blend into each other and it's hard to see that separation because Maya is darkening the side of her face, which is then blending into the hair. But if you put a light on them, the line between those shapes becomes much clearer. And just in general, their clothes are nice bright colors, but on the left, Maya's just darkening everything. So it's harder to see props, characters, environment, all of it, if you don't add lights. So with that, let me show you how to light your scenes for animation. This is a 5-minute process. It's very quick and easy. I'm gonna show you some really helpful tips, hopefully. So here we go. So let's start with Link. Now, some hotkeys you should be familiar with. 5, 6, and 7. If you hit 5 on the keyboard, it's your geometry. 6 is textures, 7 turns on the lights. If you have no lights, it becomes a silhouette, which is very useful if you're posing your character and just wanna see a silhouette. So I'm gonna show you two different workflows on how to do this. One is just kind of the basic Maya way, and then one is a slightly more efficient, I think a better way to do it, but just requires one extra step. So let me just show you. With Link, we'll do the basic way. I'm gonna open the outliner, and I'm going to go up to Create, Lights, and we're just gonna use Maya's basic built-in lights. If you want more information on lighting in 3D, what all these lights do, how it all works, I already have done a video on lights, so you can check that out if you like. I like to start off with an ambient light. Now this sometimes doesn't work at all with the certain kinds of characters. We'll get to that in a minute, but if I now hit 7 on the keyboard, you'll see that with this character, the ambient light starts to work pretty well. So I'm gonna jump over to my attribute editor and you can see that I can dial up the intensity. I can go just a little bit, or I can blow out the character entirely. And you can also use this color thing if you wanted to make it feel like a warmer day. You could add a little bit of orange, it's gonna feel more summer. You could go to a cool blue, it'll feel more wintry. If you go a lot of blue, it'll feel like he's underwater in the water temple, because we all love that water temple so much. Dial up the intensity, or you could make it go to green and then turn it way down, and it'll feel like he might just be in a forest. So you can use the colors to help sell your environment, but in this case, we're just gonna go back to using a white light. So I'll leave the intensity at 1, but I never stop at just an ambient light. I don't recommend you do it either. The reason for this is an ambient light brings out the diffuse layer. If you haven't seen my video on textures and surfacing, this is a good kind of intro to this type of stuff. But even if you haven't seen it, what the ambient light is doing is just kind of bringing out the color in the materials. But it's not doing any specular highlights. It's pretty much not giving you any directionality to that light. It's just giving a general, omnipresent, everywhere light, which isn't very natural, but it could help just kind of brighten everything up. So I'm gonna go back to create, lights, and I'm gonna pick directional. You could do spotlights, but directional lights are just easier and faster, so I'm gonna stick with those here. Directional light. Now, I'm gonna quickly zoom out. You can scale up direction lights, you can move them around. It doesn't affect the light at all. The only thing that affects them is rotation, because you're just changing where are they pointing. That's all a direction light cares about, is where are they pointing at. So at this point, all you need to do is just move it somewhere to where you can see the character and just start spinning it until you see what you like. And you'll see that you can actually give him kind of a little eye highlight as well. And then you can also dial up intensity. So if it's a bright day, we can really crank that up. You can go way too far and now there's some kind of explosion happening. If you really wanted to sell that, again, you can add some color. It's gonna feel like now there's fire or something, whatever. The idea here is that you're going from this to that. Because here you may not be able to tell where that corner of the mouse should go. Here you can see the full face, right? Now let's jump over to Dana and David, and I'm gonna show you a better way to do that, starting from scratch. I could do the same thing, or check this out. If I go to Windows, Rendering Editors, Light Editor. Don't be intimidated by this menu. What we can do is you can create, modify, and just simplify your light building experience. But for now, I'm actually just gonna move it off screen so we don't need to see it for the moment. I'm gonna do the same thing I did last time, but watch the difference. I'm gonna go to Create, Lights, and I'm gonna pick an ambient light. However, notice the difference of how these rigs behave with this light. Let me turn up the intensity a bit. See how they almost look 2D or cell shaded? They don't look 3D anymore, which is interesting. And that's just the way these rigs were set up. So if you are looking to stylize your work, you can actually use this technique with certain rigs to get a more, I don't know, 2D looking shot, which is cool, but that's not what we're after. So I'm gonna keep going. But that's part of the reason that I pretty much never stick with an ambient light. Sometimes it's the directionality of the light, and sometimes it just doesn't really work the same. So I'm just gonna turn this to, I don't know, we'll go to default value. We'll just have an intensity of 1, not doing a whole lot. So what I'm gonna do is I'm actually gonna bring back the light editor now to show you that when we create a light, it now shows up here. You could name it and just call this, so we'll just, well, we don't need to rename it, but you could rename it. You could change the color, you can change the intensity, and all those settings are right here. So you don't have to go through your outliner, you don't have to go select the light and find it, you just have it here in front of you. This will get better as we go. So next I'm gonna pick this little arrow, direction light, and that creates a new direction light, as you'd expect, and just move it out of the way. So I'm gonna do the same thing, I'll scale it up, and I'll just start spinning it. And you can see on the left how it's behaving with our scene. So what I'll look at here is I'll just look at Dana's eyes, and actually what I'm seeing, if I zoom in here, this is my 2D camera pan tool. If you haven't seen the Maya videos, these have a lot of great tips. But I'm gonna move this around and you can see that her eye light is actually being created from this light. So I like that, I'm gonna leave that be. And then I'm just going to duplicate that light and spin it some more. Say, where do I want this one to go? I'll put this one behind them. And again, like this is looking very messy on the right. We'll clean that up in a second. And what I'm liking here is two things. One, on his chest, we're getting a nice light to separate the form of his chest from the rest of his body. And also on her hair, it's giving a nice rim light. So if we have a background behind her, this is gonna help separate her hair from anything in the background, especially if it's a darker background. We now have that little bit of light separating the foreground and the background layers. Finally, what I think we need in this shot is just more light on them in general. So I'm just gonna point that straight at them from the camera, more or less. And I can dial this up and say, all right, we can see them very well. The problem with this light, in my opinion, is that they're now very shiny. You know, the light is now reflecting or bouncing off of their skin, and it's just a lot of distraction, because now we're not focused on their expressions, we're focusing on more of like the skin and light qualities as they interact, which I don't like. Here's what you do. On the right, for this direction light, if you are in the, if you're in your channel box, you just hit Control A or go to your attribute editor, and that's where all this is. You can actually just deselect emit specular, and that fixes the problem. So what you're doing is you're just turning off the light reflection. It's not really reflection, it's a specular highlight. The other video will talk about that, but you can turn that off and you're still getting the lighting. See how, you know, the diffuse aspect of it is still working. Now you can do this in reverse as well, but remember the light that I had kind of doing the eye light that was doing this? If I don't want the eye light, I can turn that off. Or if I don't want it actually lighting her, but only doing the specular, I could have that as well. So now it's, you know, you can see the slight difference. I'm gonna leave it be. Now, this can start to look a little complicated over here on the right. There's just like a lot going on. So what I'm gonna do is bring back our light editor, And this is what's gonna simplify things. So normally you have your outliner and you have your lights and you might search through them here and grab them in the 3D viewer, and that's a lot. So I'll just grab the light editor, bring this in, and then I have all my lights. And I can just say, all right, what's this one doing? And what's nice about this is when you have it this way, there's one thing in particular that I want you to see. It's that you can solo and mute layers. If you're not familiar with tools that have those options, it's to isolate select, just say like, okay, this direction light shape 2, what's that doing by itself? You can solo the layer and you can see, oh, that's all that light's doing. It's subtle. Or you can mute it and say, how does this look without that? With, without, with, without. No, I like it with. And so you can kind of troubleshoot and say, why am I having this highlight on her eye? And I can try it and say, oh, it's this one. Because if I turn it off, it goes away. And so you can try things very quickly, and you can very easily just be like, ah, I think, you know, what's this main one doing? Like, maybe it needs to be brighter. Maybe I wanna try putting them in a forest and I'll go with like a green color. Like, no, I don't like that. But it allows you to iterate more quickly. And so back to our ambient, I can turn off the ambient. Say, do we want the ambient light? I kinda like it. Is it enough? Is it too much? And it's very quick and easy to just dial these settings in and out when you have the light editor open. You can also create a group of lights. So if you like all of this stuff and that's for the characters, you can group all of that. And if you had stuff for your background, you could have, you know, other lights in the scene, and you could have things affecting different things. And you could just easily group things, solo them, mute them, and try stuff out very quickly. So if you were going to actually light your scene, groups are gonna be helpful to organize where you put stuff, because you can get a lot of lights very quickly. But in our case, this looks great. This is before and after. And the final thing is just cleaning up everything over here on the right. All these lights kind of get in the way. They can be, you can select them by accident. You could just, they're just a clutter. So to get rid of them, don't select them and then try to hide them or turn off visibility, because that'll actually turn off the lights. Once you hide them, they go away. So instead, just go up to the show menu and deselect lights. And all that's going to do is turn off the visibility of those shapes on that panel. And you can do that for multiple panels. That's how I also turn off the curves and like all the NURB shapes on these characters, so that I can just see a clean view of the geometry. It will add a little bit more processing time. It'll pull a little bit more resources from your computer to do the light. So you can choose whether you want them on all the time or some of the time or when it's useful or not. But it is important to know that that is there and available to you as a tool to be able to make better decisions with your animation, with your posing, with your motion. But if you are going to an animation school or a regular school and your mentor, your professor, your teacher, your peers, whoever it is looking at your work, they are going to be able to see your work better, just like you will, to give you better notes and critiques and feedback, because what you have put into your work will be more clear, and it's not bad that it actually will just look prettier in general. So there's that. If you found this video helpful, hit subscribe and ring that notification bell so you don't miss out when I post new videos. And if you find my videos helpful and you like what I'm doing here, consider supporting on Patreon. It's platforms like that that allow me to increase the frequency of how often I upload the kinds of videos I make. So links for Patreon and everything else I do down below, including Twitch, where we do a lot of this stuff live. If you have questions, you want to come in and chat 3 times a week, hit me down there. As always, thank you for watching all the way to the end. I appreciate it, and I will see you guys in the next video.